So in the next 20 minutes or so, I'm going to show you some technologies that we've been developing, what we call exploring the bionic space, the bionic design space. And I'll tell you what bionics is all about. So the world we know that's comprised of things that look like this exists maybe 30, 40, 50 years, 60 years. But this world exists within another world that's been around for quite longer, maybe 1 or 2 billion years. And during that time, living organisms and even molecules and groups of organisms have learned to deal with problems that we can't even approach today. And we've been learning from them how to do things. And I'm talking about technologies. So what we're interested in is technologies that's going to be that are going to be affecting our lives in the horizon of 10 to 20 years from now. So we've been interested in very futuristic technologies. So we've been trying to study and develop them right now. And I'll give you some examples of that. It begins with questions that sound quite stupid, but they're actually not. They're very good questions. For example, why when we get a wound, when we cut ourselves, our body can heal, as you can see here. And for example, if my shirt is torn, I'm throwing it and get myself a new one. So our shirts, our clothes, our furniture, they can't heal themselves. And the question is why? It's a very good question, actually. And if you look at nature, there are some organisms that can actually help us do that. So for example, this amazing organism, you all know that organism. This organism can actually make cloth. It can make fabric. And the knowledge to make fabric is encoded in a small piece of code in that organism's cells. So this is a piece of DNA, a gene that tells it how to make fabric. Now we could take that, theoretically, we could take that piece of knowledge and learn how to make fabric ourselves, except we can't. There is this amazing part of this amazing movie, which I'm sure you've all seen, in which Trinity and Neo has to take off to save Morpheus, and they have a chopper, and Neo asks Trinity, can you fly that? She says, not yet. And then she calls operator, and then he uploads her with the software teaching her how to fly a chopper in a sec. And that's how it is. And we can't do that. But there are amazing organisms, much more primitive organisms in nature that can. So bacteria, for example, which by the way, most of them are not bad at all. They're very good. Even they're very helpful to us. So bacteria can actually take that piece of code from the silk moth, and it can start making silk. So what we did is we took these bacteria, we took that piece of code, we put it inside bacteria, and we grew those bacteria, in a fabric, like you see here. And in response to tearing, in response to that mechanical stress, bacteria respond by producing fabric. So this is a fabric that can heal itself. Now, you can ask, it takes about 24 hours, by the way. So you may ask a question like, what happens with the laundry? Right? I mean, is it launderable? So the actual answer is that you can take those bacteria, you can dry them, and put them in the laundry reagent, and every time you launder your clothes, you can load your clothes with an operating system that can, you know, that can help the clothes heal themselves. So this is one example of what's bionic technology is all about. I'll give you a second example. This is much more of a game, cosmetics, actually. We call this remakeup. Why remakeup? Because this is makeup that can respond to your body. And how we do that, there is another piece of code teaching the jellyfish how to produce light. And so we took that piece of code and we put it in bacteria and we engineered them to emit light in response to the salinity in your sweat. And we put those bacteria in a cream. Now you can apply this cream on your skin, go to the club and dance. And the minute you start sweating, you also start emitting light from your skin. And this sounds funny, but we're now trying to engineer bacteria to sense other things in your sweat. For example, preliminary markers of heart attack or myocardial infarction or stroke. And then your skin will start producing light. You'll know something bad's gonna happen. So this is another example. The last example I'm gonna show, this is a circuit. You might see this is a circuit. And this circuit was not manufactured by humans, it was manufactured by bacteria. And these bacteria they have a piece of code, teaching them how to produce metals from raw materials from the environment. And this piece, this specific circuit is actually a radio receiver. You can actually listen to the radio with that. This is an example. This radio was not, again, it was not made in any clean room, it was grown. So imagine that in 5 or 10 years you'll be able to grow your own electronics. You'll be able to grow a laptop. And this, by the way, costs about 50 cents per kilogram to grow. Another thing that we're all interested in, something that we use every day, is storage. We're producing immense amounts of information. We need the means to store them also. And we're using that. So we have, for example, USB disk. We have portable memory drives. But that thing is still primitive compared with what nature has to offer. And again, I'm turning to DNA, which has evolved for over a billion years to be a storage medium for digital information. And in terms of information capacity, DNA is far more advanced. You can store about 500 exabytes per gram of DNA, which is something it's about 100,000 times better than what we have today. And the technology to synthesize, to make synthetic DNA is now very advanced. And I'm showing you a picture of George Church. George Church was my postdoc supervisor at Harvard University. And George is a world leader in DNA synthesis. And George wrote a book called Regenesis. It's a book about synthetic biology. And you can purchase that book either as a book, as a hardcover, or you can purchase it as a DNA. You can get a tube with DNA encoding the entire book, and you can sequence that DNA and read the book, and that DNA will stay for, again, it stays for millions of years in theory. There's a very easy script, a script that you can also use called bits to DNA, and that script takes a sequence of bits, turns it into DNA, into a format that DNA synthesizer can understand. And a couple of things that we did with that. This is the Mona Lisa, as you all know. And the Mona Lisa is something that's culturally very, very significant. So we want to be able to preserve it for all eternity. So what we did is we scanned the Mona Lisa. We turned the Mona Lisa into a 1D string of bits, and we turned those bits and we converted them into DNA. We synthesized that DNA and we put them in the egg cell of a mouse, right? The oocyte of a mouse. And we were able to grow a line of mice that has the entire DNA encoding the Mona Lisa inside their cells. Now, a mouse is much, much better than a computer because a mouse is designed to protect its DNA. That's the prime directive of the mouse, is to protect the DNA inside its cells. And now it can also protect, for example, it can run from threats, it can hunt. It protects the entire set of instructions of, we can reconstruct the Mona Lisa if something's ever going to happen to it. And another thing we're now doing, because it's much, much more information, but we're synthesizing the entire Wikipedia, and we're going to put that inside the genome of an apple. We call that the apple of knowledge, Pri Etz Hadat. So, of course, it doesn't mean if you'll eat that apple, you'll be able to understand Wikipedia, but it means that that apple is going to store Wikipedia basically for all eternity. We can update the genome of the apple, basically have a version every year to do that. So you can do also other things with DNA. You can not only store information, you can also build amazingly precise nanostructures from DNA. This is a technique called DNA origami. Basically, you take long pieces of DNA, synthetic DNA, and you program that DNA to fold into any 2D or 3D shape you want. So these black and white images are real images of objects folded from DNA. The smileys that you see here are about 100 nanometers from cheek to cheek, and we can synthesize billions and billions of them in a reaction that takes about 10 minutes. You can also do it in your home, in your own microwave, and it costs pretty much nothing because DNA is so cheap today. And what you see here is something that we built about 3 years ago. So these are, the cubic objects you see here are actual machines. These are machines, they have moving parts, they have software and hardware, and you can program them to do all kinds of things, which I'm gonna show you in a couple of minutes. A close-up on these machines We'll show you that the actual machine looks like a shell. It's a hexagonal shell, looks like a barrel that can that's made entirely from a double helix of DNA, folded onto itself. Inside that shell, you can load payloads such as drugs, molecular tools like enzymes that cut your tissue, stitch your tissue. Like basically, you can use an enzyme that cut the tissue. It's like a scalpel, except it's a scalpel 10,000 times sharper than the sharpest scalpel we have today. So you can do all that, and then you program the robot to search and probe the topography, the surface area of target cells and tissues in your body. And the robot can, using a very special form of machine learning, it's basically molecular machine learning. It's a form of supervised learning, just like you do when you develop computer algorithms. Now we're developing algorithms written in DNA, in the DNA code, enabling the robots to probe and understand which cell is bad and which cell is normal, and they can differentiate between those. And when they do, they undergo this significant conformational shift, and they look like that. And then the tools become exposed, so the tools can now work on those cells, those target cells or tissues. And we have robots today that can recognize about 12 types of tumors, both solid tumors and blood tumors. They can kill them without doing anything to the animal harboring the tumor. I'll show you a movie, a very unusual movie, pictured inside an artificial blood vessel. So this is a blood vessel. It's lined with cells. You have the cells making up the blood vessel itself, endothelial cells, all kinds of cells inside. But the cells in that yellow frame are metastatic cells. These are tumor cells, in Hebrew, gruah. Okay, these are tumor cells that were disconnected from the main tumor and implanted themselves to start a new tumor somewhere in your body. You all know that process. And we're injecting millions of nanorobots. They're scanning. They're starting to probe every square nanometer of the tissue. And they identify the interface between the target cells and the background tissue. And they can disconnect them using enzymes, and they kill them. So they don't enable the cells to metastasize and go someplace else. That's how it looks. So it takes a few seconds. Basically, now we injected the robots, and that's it. Those cells will die in a matter of a couple of hours. They can also mimic, the robots can also mimic group behaviors like animals or termites. We can teach them, we can program them to form architectures that do amazing things. For example, logic gates. So these are pictures of robots that interact to emulate logical functions. They can actually decide. You can inject those robots into your body, into the body of a patient, and the robots can decide based on what they find in the patient which combination of drugs to activate, because you know cancer therapy is usually based on combinations. And so this is one example. This is a close-up of such architecture of robots. It looks like a random clump of robots, but in fact these robots actually emulate a part of a processor architecture, and we can know that because we can track the type of each robot. Each robot has a type here, and together we can actually track down the actual decision that they're making, the actual architecture they're emulating, and sort of track down the decision that they made and see whether we programmed them well or not. And we recently published that. This is a very a paper from April, and hopefully in a year or two, hopefully before that, we'll be able to show that in human trials, the first nanorobots that can treat cancer. We started a company recently to make these into a product. So I'll finish with a couple of short examples. We're very interested in manufacturing. Again, bionics can have a very large impact on manufacturing. Everything in our world is based on assembly lines. Everything is assembled. For example, my iPhone is assembled on an assembly line. Assembly lines are very costly. A lot of people. But if you look at nature, you see that, for example, viruses can assemble on their own. So this is a herpes virus. You know that a virus enters your cells. It doesn't duplicate itself. It duplicates the subunits that make up the virus. And the subunits self-assemble into the virus itself. This is a movie. This is a movie showing that. So you can, this is, of course, a plastic model of a virus. But all you can see that once you design your whole object from smart building blocks that can self-assemble, all you need to do is just mix those bricks, inject some energy into the system, and within a couple of seconds, in this case, the building blocks, these yellow discrete parts can actually make the whole object. This is called self-assembly. Now imagine you can took all the parts of this iPhone, shake them in a jar, and voila, they make an iPhone on their own. You don't need anyone assembling that. And we've developed this amazing technology, which I still can't show you, but I hope that within a year or two, you're going to have a box of tools, like hammers, screwdrivers, and everything. A box of tools made out of one set of 1,024 bricks that you can shake in a box. Take out a hammer, you can use the hammer, put it in the box, shake it again, take out a screwdriver, use the screwdriver, put it back in the box, take out something else. From the same set of bricks, they can make anything you want by self-assembly. A couple of more short examples and I'll finish. We've been studying the architecture of these amazing birds. These are swiftlets living in caves in Southeast Asia. These nests are made for preparing soup. I don't know if you ever heard about bird nest soup. So these are the nests made by these birds. The bird weaves them from its own hardened saliva, like spiders weave webs, like spider make webs. So this bird actually makes a single nest. Takes it about 45 days to manufacture a single nest. And all the nests look alike. There's one single design governing all the nests in the colony of the birds. And we used high-resolution medical imaging to understand what's so special about that nest. And we found out something really extraordinary. We found out that if you look at the microscale, you see that in a resolution of voxels of 34 microns, the bird actually builds the nest as a three-dimensional maze. It's actually a maze. And the question was why. And we found out that it took us a year to realize that this maze has a certain topology that's not enabling crawling its surfaces. You know that you can solve easily a maze by crawling one of its surface. It's called a wall follower algorithm. So this nest is built as a maze, not allowing wall following to solve it. And who's following the walls of the nest? Bacteria. The bacteria that endanger this bird, the bird's colony, the bacteria that can spread from nest to nest, they are trapped in the nest. The walls of the nest actually trap bacteria from moving. And these are computer models of the nest. And we actually tracked bacteria trying to move through the nest, and they weren't able to do that. And so we patented that architecture, and we're now building, we're planning on starting building a hospital with the walls built with this exact microarchitecture, meaning that the bacteria won't be able to move from room to room anymore. And we told that story to Lenovo, to the Lenovo company, the company that makes computers. And they were like that, and we asked, they were really, really shocked. And we said, why are you so interested in that friggin' bird nest? And they said that one of the major challenges in the ergonomics of personal computers is the keyboard. The keyboard is a gigantic pool of bacteria growing on the keys. And we made some keys with the exact microarchitecture inspired by the bird nest. So you don't feel anything because the architecture is microscopic, but you can dip your fingers in bacteria and use the computer, and the person coming to use the computer after you won't catch those bacteria because they're actually trapped. They're actively trapped and they're dying in a matter of a couple of days inside those keys. So the keyboard is not a pool for bacteria anymore, and now we're progressing in that direction also. And the last thing I'm going to show to you is pandemics. So we're really concerned about pandemics, especially influenza pandemics. And so the best way to avoid a pandemic, or the best way to handle pandemics, is simply to know where the virus is and not be there. It sounds stupid, but it's actually the case. So if you could identify where the virus is in real time, and you can contain that area, you would stop the pandemic, you would stop the disease. Okay? So even if you don't have a treatment, it means you can confine an area, so the poor people remaining inside will likely die, but the rest of humanity will be salvaged. And so the question is how you do that, how you find where the virus is in real time. So you all know that there are tools, for example, Google Trends, which can show you trends of all kinds of peaks, but these peaks don't show you where the virus is. This red peak, for example, completely is equivalent to the peak of the 2009 flu pandemic. So, but it doesn't show you the actual virus. It shows you where people looked for the word virus or flu symptoms. And so what we developed is a sensor. This sensor can actually go, it's a very small sensor, it costs less than $1 to make, and it can plug into your USB port or the headphone jack of your smartphone, of your Android. And that sensor is an extremely sensitive sensor composed of carbon nanotubes, functionalized with all kinds of things you can see here. And this is me, by the way, in another phase of my life, in a eureka sort of phase, eureka sort of position. So the sensor is extremely sensitive. These peaks that you see here are readings of 10 single virus particles, 10 single viruses. There's no sensor in the world currently. Even your immune system can't sense 10 virus particles, needs much more than that. And we've built this application, this server that, you know, so we've been giving these to people, to our friends. There are a bit more than 100 people walking around with these sensors inside their Androids or PCs. And whenever each of them catches a virus, they send the coordinate, the GPS coordinates and the timestamp to our server, so we can sort of reconstruct the real-time map. This is a real-time map of Tel Aviv. It was constructed over a week. And what's nice that you can see, this is a density of flu viruses, or things that looked like flu viruses. The most interesting thing is that what you see here, right, so in the middle, that big spot in the middle, this is Ichilov Hospital. And this is right by that, it's Azrieli. And over there, that's the Mitram Abursa. I don't know how to say that properly in English. So, and it occurred to us that people might not be the ideal carriers for these sensors. And we think we just found the ideal carriers. This is a cat. This is a cat walking with a going around with a collar configured sensor. And cats are amazing because they're three-dimensional. They also climb. They go underground. It's not, and humans and dogs are more or less confined to ground level. And cats can give us a very good coverage of virus of an entire city in terms of readings. So with that, I'd like to finish, and I hope you enjoyed and understood what Bionics is all about. Thank you very much.